Hey, what's going on, everybody? Commander Crane here, and we are back with another Pioneer Deck Tech. And today, we're going to be talking about Gruul Morph / Disguise Aggro in Pioneer. I'm very excited to bring this list to you. So we got a couple things that we got to go over before we hop into the deck tech here. So as always, at the end of the video, let me know in the comment section below, what do you think about the list? Is there any card that I didn't include that I definitely should have? Just let me know in the comment section below. The other thing is, this is pretty much our third deck tech that we're featuring with new cards from the Murders at Karlov Manor. If you haven't checked out those other decks, you definitely should. They're going to be in the same playlist as this deck list will be. And the last thing I got to mention is, if you have any suggestions for upcoming videos, just let me know in the comment section below. So, okay, this was not really... I was trying to find a good name for this deck. And so, essentially, it's playing this card. It's playing Yaris, Roar of the Old Gods, and it's obviously a card that matters about face-down creatures, that kind of thing. So I figured, you know, I'd try to, like, come up with a, you know, a really cool name, and I really couldn't. So, but anyways, Yaris, Roar of the Old Gods. 4/4/4, legendary creature, centaur, druid. Other creatures you control have haste. Well, that's already fantastic. Whenever one or more face-down creatures you control deal combat damage to a player, draw a card. And whenever a face-down creature you control dies, return it to the battlefield face-down under its owner's control if it's a permanent card. Then turn it face-up. Okay, so obviously this card 100% matters about all the face-down cards from the new set at the time of this recording anyways, Murders at Karlov Manor. So, but here's the thing. There's a ton of cards from older sets, like the Morph and the Megamorph cards from, like, the Cons block, that still work really, really well with this. They don't have the Ward 2 like the new ones do, but they're still really, really powerful. So let's go and hop into the deck here. So, one drops. Lanowarf, Elvish Mystic, pretty self-explanatory. They don't morph, but they're still really, really good, and they help us do what we want to do in this deck. But we are playing 4 Obscuring Aether, 1 green enchantment, face down creature spells you cast, cost 1 less to cast, and then for 1 and a green, turn it face down. So, obviously, being able to make our face down creatures 1 less is fantastic. So instead of paying 3 for them, we're paying 2, which can kind of really help snowball, which is pretty sweet. And then obviously late game, if we end up drawing this, we can just turn it face down and make it a 2-2 creature. Not the most efficient thing technically late game, but hey, it's better than nothing. We get a 2-2 that can maybe do some things with our other guy here. So okay, so those are our one drops. Let's go and hop into what I think is the meat of the deck. We're playing 4 Den Protector, quite the throwback from Dragons of Tarkir. This card, for those who didn't play standard in this era, Den Protector is so good. We play it as the 2-2 for 3, then Megamorph, 1 and a green, put a 1-1 counter on it, and turn it face up. And then when it's turned face up, return target card from your graveyard to your hand. It could be anything. Den Protector is fantastic. We're also playing 4 Pyrotechnic Performer, new card from Murders at Karlov Manor. 3-2 for 2 with Disguise Red. So we cast it face down for 3 as a 2-2 creature with Ward 2. And then we could turn it face up anytime for Disguise cost, which is a red. And then whenever it or another creature you control is turned face up, that creature deals damage equal to its power to each opponent. That's an extremely good rate. Whenever we're turning our creatures up, we're dealing a bunch of damage with them. And what's great, obviously, with... I'm forgetting his name all of a sudden. It's Yarak. Let's go back. Yaris. I always keep forgetting the guy's name. Yaris. So with Yaris, it's when you turn it face up with the death ability. Well, the die ability, whatever. And then you trigger this Pyrotechnic Performer, which is pretty sweet. So definitely a big fan of it. It's also 3-2 for 2. It's just an extremely good rate. We're also playing 4 Death Mist Raptor. I love Death Mist Raptor, not because it's a dinosaur, just because it's a sweet card. 3-3 for 3. Whenever a permanent you control is turned face up, you may return Death Mist Raptor from your graveyard to the battlefield face up or face down. And then it has Megamorph for 4 and a green. It comes in as a 2-2 for 3, and then we can Megamorph it, put a 1-1 counter on it, and turn it face up. So works really well with the Den Protector as well. Figured I'd mention that. Deathmist Raptor is just going to keep on coming back. It's going to be really annoying for our opponent. It's also a really good body. You know, 3-3 Death Toucher can be a 4-4 Death Toucher. It just trades with any creature our opponent has. The card is extremely powerful. Definitely very happy to have a deck finally to feature Deathmist Raptor. So, last slide here is pretty self-explanatory. We're playing 4 Whisperwood Elemental. I knew when I was building this deck, I knew this was one of the cards that I was definitely going to want to play. 4-4 for 5. At the beginning of your end step, manifest the top card of your library, which means we put it on the battlefield face down as a 2-2 creature, and then we can sacrifice Whisperwood Elemental. Until end of turn, face up non-token creatures you control gain whenever this creature dies, manifest the top card of your library. So pretty much if Whisperwood's gonna die, we might as well just cash it in. So that way if our other guys die, we manifest the top. if we're in a weird situation, we also could, like, just chump block, and then we could, like, boom, trigger that or whatever. Whisperwood is just really, really good. We get a nice body at every end step. And obviously, we're playing a ton of, like, face-up, face-down synergies, so it's really, overall, it's a pretty good situation for us. And then as our main removal spell for the deck, we're playing four Obliterating Bolt. I considered Bonecrusher Giant, I really did, which I think still could be the right option, but I wanted to play Obliterating Bolt. It's kind of just bigger reach, kills more things, that kind of thing. Definitely a big fan of Obliterating Bolt. So that's our entire main board, because we're playing a bunch of four ofs and we're playing 24 lands, just because I wanted to make sure we had the mana to be able to turn everything face up, maybe do multiple things, turn things face up, play another morph, that kind of thing. We really don't want to be missing our land drops in a deck like this. So we're playing four Copper Line, four Stomping Ground, and four Carplusion Force. Obviously, pretty self-explanatory, powerful lands, dual lands of the format. We're also playing four Cryocrown Pathway, one Basaju, one Sakenzin. Pretty self-explanatory for those who've been watching the channel for a while. Pretty much the same mana base for a Gruul deck, you know, really nothing too crazy. And then rounding out our lands, we're playing two Lairs and two Branch of V2 Ghazi. Again, Branch, one of the new cards from Murders at Karlov Manor. We can disguise it for three. So for three mana, make it a 2-2 with Ward 2, and then disguise three, transform it. And then when it's turned face up, add two mana of any one color till end of turn. You don't lose this mana as steps and phases end. I'm going to be honest with you, we're not going to really turn this up very often. Most of the reason we're playing it is so we have that option to make it a 2-2 with Ward 2. But, you know, sometimes if we are like, we don't have double green or something like that, we turn up for three. I don't know. It's kind of a weird effect for the most part. But again, mostly just playing it because it's another thing we can play as a 2-2 with Ward 2. And then rounding out our lands, we're playing one Forest and one Mountain. As our spicy basic land of the day, I decided to do the Fate Reforged basics. I don't think I've ever featured these on the channel before, but, you know, we're playing a bunch of morph cards, reminding me of, like, the original Khan's block, that kind of thing. So I figured we'd go ahead and feature some of the cool Fate Reforged lands as opposed to, you know, like, the full arts that most people play. So, but anyways, so don't go anywhere yet. We still have to talk about our sideboarding as well as some budget options for the deck. So sideboarding is pretty self-explanatory. We're going to want some Graveyard Hate. Tormod's Crypt and Gravedigger's Cage, I think, are the best options that you can play. Tormod's Crypt is also great because it functions as hate for the Amalia combo. We're going to want some extra removal. Cards like Abrade, Rending Volley are fantastic to play in that slot. Obviously, there's other things you could play, but that's personally what I would recommend. We're also going to want some anti-life gain once again for the Amalia combo that's kind of going around everywhere right now. So I would personally play a card like Rampaging Ferocidon. You could also play Roiling Vortex, which is also really good against the Quintorious combo deck. That's personally what I would recommend. If you want to check out the exact list that I'm playing as well as the sideboard, it's going to be in the link in the description below if you want to know exactly what I'm playing. And then the last thing is some budget options. It's pretty simple. We're going to want to trim the utility lands like the Basaju, the Sakenzin, that kind of thing. We can just go and add more basics in there. Then we'll go ahead and play some of the more budget dual lands. That means like the temples, the brand new surveil lands from Murders at Karlov Manor. I don't think those are going to be too much, so you could probably slot those in. You could also play, oh man, what's another good budget dual land? You could play Rockfall Veil. That's also pretty good. Those only go for about $2 a piece. That's what I would recommend. And the one thing I wanted to mention is this deck is easily under $100. You could probably even get it to $50. Most of the creatures are kind of like bulk rares that really don't see a lot of play anymore except for Commander. I mean, realistically, of all the creatures that we played, really none of them see a lot of mainstay Pioneer play for the most part. I really do like the new cards at Murders at Karlov Manor. I think it definitely opens up, you know, a new strategy, which most sets do. And I think this card is just awesome. I think all the new cards I disguise, I think technically I'm really new to these cards still, but I think they're fantastic. And it's really cool just to be able to play a brand new aggro deck, you know, that kind of thing, instead of just playing Reckless Stormseeker dot Gruul deck, that kind of thing. It's kind of cool to switch things up a little bit here. So that's the entire deck. I'd like to thank everybody for watching this video. Let me know in the comment section below, what was the your favorite card that was featured up in this deck tech? Just let me know in the comment section below. So I'm Commander Crane. Thanks for watching this video. And I'll catch you in the next one.